5 years or so, I've been reading many articles and watching many videos on 9/11. And as a result, I've 4 or 5 years ago, I co-founded the Boston 9/11 Truth Group, which is still very active and has done a lot over the last 5 years to bring different experts in the area of 9/11, from architects to David Ray Griffin to Graeme MacQueen. Well, he's not here as a result of Boston 9/11 Truth. I was asked to introduce Graeme, so I'm honored to be here and just read a little briefly who Graeme MacQueen is. But before I do that, I just wanted to read a quote of Paul Craig Roberts, who was in the Ronald Reagan Treasury Department way back when. But he's an investigative journalist, and I've read many of his articles over the years, and I think he's right on point. And the piece of the article I just wanted to read simply states, "America's fate was sealed when the public and the anti-war movement bought the government's 9/11 conspiracy theory. The government's account of 9/11 is contradicted by much evidence. Nevertheless, this defining event of our time, which has launched the U.S. on interminable wars of aggression and a domestic police state, is a taboo topic for investigation in the media. It is pointless to complain of war and a police state when one accepts the premise upon which they are based." And I'm happy to say, and that's the only reason I'm here tonight, is that Graeme is not one of those peace activists who accepts the premise on which these wars are based. He's willing to look at facts, he's willing to dig deep, he's willing to face whatever his digging shows him. Graeme was born in Nova Scotia. He received his Ph.D. in Buddhist studies from Harvard University and taught in the Religious Studies Department of McMaster University in Ontario for 30 years. In 1989, he became founding director of the Center for Peace Studies at McMaster, after which he helped develop the BA program in peace studies and oversaw peace-building projects in Sri Lanka, Gaza, Croatia, and Afghanistan. He has also contributed to the development of the Women's Peace Brigade in North India, which is still active in several states today, and was involved for some years in the Third Option, a peace initiative for Afghanistan. He has chaired the National Coordinating Council of Peace Brigades International in Canada, and has been chair of the Board of Peace Magazine and other organizations devoted to peace. He has been a visiting lecturer at the European Peace University in Austria, and has published numerous peer-reviewed articles and book chapters, as well as 4 books. He recently took early retirement to devote all his time to peace and justice work. For the past 5 years, most of Graeme's research has focused on the events and anomalies of 9/11. He has written 4 research articles on the subject and has given many talks and interviews. I want to welcome Graeme MacQueen.
Thank you very much for that kind introduction, Joe, and thank you to all those who helped make this visit possible, especially to Martha Nalband at the back there, who gave tirelessly many, many hours of creative work to make this happen. And it's also good to be back to Harvard. Now, I have a fair bit to say, and I hope you'll find that there's not much rhetoric. My attempts in my talks are to give evidence and good reasoning. I really don't enjoy trying to persuade people that I'm right. I find it annoying to myself and to them. But I don't mind trying to persuade people to look into this issue. This issue is important. If you look into it seriously on your own, I'm convinced that you will decide that there are some very disturbing anomalies. And now let's get to it. The year 2001 was the United Nations Year of Dialogue Among Civilizations. President Khatami of Iran proposed the idea. Secretary General Kofi Annan championed it. And the UN General Assembly certified and loudly proclaimed it. The whole thing was meant to emphasize, and they were quite explicit about this, Kofi Annan was quite explicit about this, the whole thing was meant to emphasize that we didn't have to enter into a clash of civilizations of the kind described by the late Samuel Huntington of
Harvard
University. We could instead choose to embrace a dialogue of civilizations. But in the fall of 2001, somebody carried out two violent attacks on the United States. The perpetrators appeared to be foreign, Muslim extremists. If the leaders in the West had plans for dialogue with the Muslim world, these were now moved to the very back of the shelf. The United States government brought forward a different plan. The new plan was for a global war on terror, which would pit the West, led by the US, against a series of movements and states in the Muslim world. The new war would involve political changes at home, such as empowering the executive branch of government, strengthening intelligence institutions, and restricting civil rights. It would involve changes abroad, heightened Western aggression, diminished regard for international law. It would have no fixed endpoint, and it would take priority over other domestic and foreign needs. The war on terror would now force us to slow down in our attempts to deal with climate change, the decline of fossil fuels, and other severe problems that we all face as a species on this planet. It was time for us to get enthusiastic about the clash of civilizations. Although it can be argued that the war on terror was actually launched in the late 1970s, I'm concerned today with its most recent and dangerous phase. Initiated in the fall of 2001 on the basis of the attacks of 9/11 and the subsequent anthrax mailings. I'm going to argue that the US government's accounts of both of these are fictional. And when I call them fictional, I don't just mean that they are constructed narrative accounts, which is, after all, obvious. I mean they describe things that didn't happen. They omit things that did happen. I mean the accounts aren't true accounts, but are the result of deliberate deception. I intend to devote most of my talk tonight to the events of 9/11, but I want to begin with a brief summary of the anthrax attacks. I have discovered recently that it is a useful way into the discussion of 9/11. On September 18th, a week after 9/11, an envelope was mailed containing a threatening letter and a quantity of anthrax spores. In all, over the next few weeks, at least seven such letters were mailed, five to the media and two to U.S. senators of the Democratic Party. At least 22 people became infected, some with cutaneous anthrax and some with inhalational anthrax. Five people died. This anthrax was clearly weaponized, and I say that without the slightest hesitation, even though at the moment the FBI denies that it was weaponized. To weaponize anthrax simply means to prepare and modify the spores in such a way as to increase their lethality and their ease of use as weapons. Those who've studied these spores in the laboratory, especially those sent to the two Democratic senators, have made it clear that the spores were modified in this way, and that therefore they were weaponized. And this means, my friends, that the United States, in the fall of 2001, was attacked with a weapon of mass destruction. And the question we want to ask is, who had the audacity to attack the United States with a weapon of mass destruction? Here's the first anthrax letter that was recovered. You'll note first the date at the top, 9/11. You'll then see, this is next, take penicillin now. Death to America, death to Israel, Allah is great. Well, the authors of this letter obviously have a story that they want us to believe. For a start, they want us to believe that they, the perpetrators, are connected to the attacks of 9/11. Notice the date at the top. The same date, printed the same way, occurs on the second anthrax letter that was recovered, which was mailed much later. It's clear that they used this date deliberately, and that they want to connect the anthrax attacks to 9/11. And although it's not a theme I'm going to get into tonight, there are several fascinating incidents, at least six, which became known in the fall of 2001, which were clearly linking the 9/11 hijackers to anthrax. We're not supposed to think about these links nowadays because the anthrax story fell to pieces. And people clearly don't want the failing anthrax story to drag down the 9/11 story. So now we're told that they're separate events and we shouldn't think about them together. But initially we were told to understand that we had to think about them together. So this date, 9/11, on the letters is actually quite important. Secondly, notice that the spore preparations, that although the spore preparations themselves were extremely sophisticated, and this is especially true of the spores in the letters to the senators, the authors of the letter can't spell penicillin. So we're supposed to believe that whoever prepared the anthrax had money and technical sophistication, but whoever sent the letters was somehow crude and rough. There is a great deal of evidence, which I don't have time to rehearse this evening, to suggest that the story we were supposed to believe had a double perpetrator. Responsible for the crude letters was Al-Qaeda. And not only Al-Qaeda in general, but individuals directly connected to the 9/11 hijackers. But behind these immediate perpetrators lurked a state capable of manufacturing the very sophisticated anthrax. And this state was Iraq. So this is my summary of what the story was supposed to be. The immediate attacker with this anthrax was Al-Qaeda. But behind Al-Qaeda lurked Iraq. I obviously offer this little graphic not as evidence of anything. This is just a way of trying to summarize symbolically what was presented to us very intensively during October of 2001. On October 14th, the British newspaper The Guardian reported that, quote, American investigators probing anthrax outbreaks in Florida and New York believe they have all the hallmarks of a terrorist attack, and they have named Iraq as prime suspect as the source of the deadly spores. And The Guardian says that there's now increasing pressure on the United States to militarily attack Iraq. This is just 1 month after the 9/11 attacks. On the following day, October 15th, the Wall Street Journal had an article on the anthrax attacks and said this: several circumstantial links to Osama bin Laden and his Al-Qaeda network are already known, as you see in the little graphic here. But bin Laden couldn't be doing all this in Afghan caves. The leading supplier suspect has to be Iraq. In late October, ABC News said several times that multiple independent sources had assured ABC that researchers had discovered the substance bentonite among the anthrax spores. Since bentonite was used by Iraq to help weaponize its anthrax, these spores bore Saddam's signature. This intensive October 2001 attempt to put responsibility on a double Islamic perpetrator mirrors, in a curious way, a fictional event that preceded the anthrax attacks by 3 months. On June 22nd to 23rd, 2001, a military training exercise called Dark Winter was conducted at Andrews Air Force Base in Washington, D.C. This exercise simulated a bioweapons attack on the United States. The biological agent in this was smallpox rather than anthrax, but the perpetrators were judged to be Iraq and an unnamed set of intermediaries. The exercise included anonymous threatening letters mailed to major media and containing, quote, a genetic fingerprint of the smallpox strain causing the current epidemic. So in other words, 3 months before the actual bioweapons attack, a fictional bioweapons attack took place with a similar double perpetrator, Iraq and presumably Islamic intermediary. And this fictional bioattack also had letters to the media. Did the fictional scenario of June owe its prescience to its having been based on superb intelligence? Or was the narrative being pushed in October as fictional as the earlier narrative, acting out in Dark Winter? Well, it quickly became clear that the October narrative, the Iraq al-Qaeda narrative, was indeed fictional. The attempt to frame al-Qaeda and Iraq ran into trouble quite quickly when the perpetrators were unable to gain complete control over the science of the study of the anthrax, as well as of the political process. Tom Ridge of the newly formed Department of Homeland Security announced as early as November of 2001 that, contrary to what ABC had repeatedly claimed, there was no bentonite in the anthrax, and no researcher had ever said that there was. In 2002, the Armed Forces Institute of Pathology, and this is the crucial newsletter in which they report their findings, they were given spores from the Tom Daschle letter, and they studied them, and they are proud of their report. Yeah. So this institute supported Tom Ridge. It said the additive they found among the spores was indeed used to help aerosolize the anthrax spores, to coat them so that they would spread into the air more quickly and easily and get into people's lungs and kill them. So obviously it was weaponized. But it was not bentonite. It was not the substance used by Iraq. In January of 2002, in fact, Ridge said that the evidence now was starting to suggest that the anthrax came from a domestic U.S. source. In other words, the anthrax were increasingly appearing to be what is colloquially known as an inside job. In fact, the anthrax used in the attacks was the Ames strain of anthrax, originally discovered in the wild of Texas in 1981, and used after that mainly in labs of the United States and its allies. There wasn't a scrap of evidence that Al-Qaeda or Iraq had ever gotten hold of the Ames strain. And moreover, the methods used to weaponize the spores, including coating them with silicon dioxide, were actually closer to U.S. methods than Iraqi methods. By 2002, almost everyone agreed that the attacks came from inside the U.S. military and intelligence community, and that Muslims had been framed. And you want to just remember the letter, which we're all supposed to forget about now. The letter was very clear. It's a little calling card. Hello, we're extremist Muslims. Praise to Allah, we hate you and we want to hurt you. And it was a fraud. Okay. Of course, by this time, the fictional story of the dual Islamic perpetrator had played its part. It had encouraged Americans to permit the restriction of their civil rights, that famous and important October. We hear a lot about September 2001. October was just as important. October 2001 was the month the USA Patriot Act made its way through Congress and into law. The fictional story of the dual Islamic perpetrators also helped persuade Americans to allow the invasion of Afghanistan,
which began 2 days after the first anthrax victim died. It had done its part in putting Americans in a mood that would allow the buildup of forces that would eventually culminate in the 2003 invasion of Iraq. Well, what would be the new story that would replace story A? Story A being the tale of the extremist Muslims. If Al-Qaeda and Iraq didn't commit the crime, who did? There seem to me to be four broad possibilities. I use these four quadrants: foreign individual, domestic individual, foreign group, domestic group. It may seem a bit formal, but I find it helpful for my own thinking to keep this little chart in front of me in times like this. Initially, we were led to believe the perpetrators were quadrant three, Al-Qaeda Iraq, foreign group. But when scientists undercut the Al-Qaeda Iraq hypothesis, the FBI was in a dilemma. It had to abandon quadrant three. Nobody had been pushing for quadrant one, foreign individual. Who cares about a foreign individual? And quadrant four, I think you should remember, has to be avoided at all costs. Domestic group. Therefore, rather predictably, the crime, they concluded, was committed by a lone perpetrator, and not only that, but the classic lone nut. After years of confusion, the FBI settled in 2008 on Dr. Bruce Ivins as the lone nut of choice. Dr. Ivins was a research scientist who had spent years working on a vaccine for anthrax. His office was in Fort Detrick, Maryland, and he conveniently died a week before being publicly named by the FBI as perpetrator. He will never be defended in a court of law. He allegedly committed suicide by taking an overdose of Tylenol. This gentleman had assisted the FBI in their investigations of the anthrax mailings, and very early had been given a polygraph test, which he passed. The recent 92-page report by the Department of Justice, which makes the case for Bruce Ivins as the lone perpetrator, has, however, fallen from the press with a thud. Many people are not convinced. Even articles in the mainstream press, the Wall Street Journal, for example, have rejected the FBI's conclusion. By the way, I recommend that you read it. 92 pages, this is a lot. The whole thing is on the internet. You can download it, print it, read it the way I do. In my view, the evidence presented there varies. At its best, it's circumstantial. At its worst, it is offensively ludicrous. There are a number of good reasons to reject this report, but those most commonly discussed have to do with the science of the spores and their preparation. To put the matter briefly, there were several quite different skills required to produce this highly sophisticated product. And I'm talking about the anthrax and the letters to the senators. The anthrax spores had to be cultured and cleaned. They had to be 1.5 to 3 micrometers in diameter, which research had shown previously was perfect for entering the human lungs, getting past the obstructions, and then staying there instead of being breathed out again. They had to be dried, because otherwise they're not particularly dangerous to the lungs. Then they had to be treated in several ways to reduce their natural tendency to stick together and form clumps. They were apparently given a weak electrostatic charge, so they would disperse readily in the air. They all had the same charge, so they tended to repel each other. It was a sophisticated aerosol that was produced, to the point where when the young woman, the assistant or secretary, opened the letter for, I believe it was Tom Daschle, she just kind of shrieked, and the a lot of the stuff just floated off and invisibly dispersed, contaminating this entire huge building. This was very sophisticated stuff. Anthrax doesn't do that naturally. So they were coated with silicon dioxide, and according to some researchers, also with a polymerized glass, which they say bound the silica to the spore coat. According to several well-informed scientists, Bruce Ivins did not possess the required skill set, nor for that matter did he have access to the required equipment. In fact, it seems very unlikely that any individual had the required skill set. As one researcher has commented, this was a multidisciplinary effort. On April 22nd of this year, in other words, a month ago, Dr. Henry Hine, a microbiologist who supervised Ivins at Fort Detrick, appeared before a panel of the National Academy of Sciences. He reminded the panel that according to the FBI, Ivins had logged a suspicious extra 34 hours in his lab prior to the anthrax mailings, which the FBI feels was adequate for preparing the anthrax. Hines said the FBI's estimate was, quote, more than 8,000 hours short of what he would have needed to grow the anthrax, end of quote. Hines' statement shows how weak the case is against Ivins, but it does more. It casts doubt on any scenario involving an opportunistic individual. The required 8,000 hours to grow the anthrax and the additional time to further weaponize the spores are more likely, surely, to have been expended by a group which was planning this attack, obviously, well before 9/11. I think it is quite clear that we are looking at a quadrant four operation. The suppressed option, in this case as in other cases as well, of a similar nature. Story A about the extremist Muslims was fiction, but in my view, so was story B. The story about the lone nut and his pathetic little world. The truth appears to be that a group of people in the heart of the US military and intelligence community with access to anthrax of the most sophisticated kind, you can't just walk in and pick it out of a test tube, carried out a false flag attack on its own country with a weapon of mass destruction. This attack furthered this group's apparent aims to work the domestic population, that means you, into a state of fear, to strengthen the executive as well as the military and intelligence communities, and to allow the occupation of strategic Muslim lands. In the anthrax affair, the war on terror was nurtured with fiction. It still is. The FBI continues to insist on story B, but I can assure you we have not heard the last of this matter. This is one of the areas where the anthrax stories differ from the 9/11 story. There are many scientists, and have been right from the outside, from the beginning, who have said this is nonsense what the FBI is doing. There are senators that are saying it's nonsense. There are people calling for a proper investigation. I don't think people are going to let this one lie. And I find it's an interesting way to get into the 9/11 issue. Because here we had, a week after 9/11, a group of people, I'm quite sure it's a group, in the heart of this US military complex, carrying out an attack on the domestic population and potentially lethal attack on two US senators with weapons of mass destruction in order to frame Muslims. Now, isn't that interesting? So we're supposed to believe that a week before that, real Muslims, real extremists, actually carried out an attack, and a week later, fake Muslims carried out a follow-up attack. It's possible, I suppose, But I think it's quite legitimate for us to begin asking radical questions about 9/11 once we have considered the anthrax attacks. And now, after that brief summary, and I'm quite aware it's a summary, you'll have to do your own research to get into it and make up your own mind, we turn to the famous events of 9/11. You'll remember Condoleezza Rice saying at her appearance before the 9/11 Commission that she never could have imagined anyone taking planes and slamming them into the Pentagon or the World Trade Center. We get the impression that while Al-Qaeda was off in Afghanistan having a kind of creative brainstorm about how to attack the United States, people in a position to defend the U.S. were just plumb out of ideas. I'm afraid I don't buy this. Dark Winter, the bioweapons exercise of June 2001, showed plenty of imagination. Similar military exercises suggestive of the events of 9/11 are a matter of record. In 1998, a training exercise at the White House involved anti-American militants filling a Learjet with explosives and flying it on a suicide mission toward a target in Washington, D.C. In the 2 years before the September 11th attacks, the North American Aerospace Defense Command conducted exercises simulating hijacked airplanes used as weapons to crash into targets and cause mass casualties. One of these targets was the World Trade Center. On October 24th to 26th in the year 2000, the U.S. military held a training exercise including a scenario with a commercial airliner crashing into the Pentagon and killing 341 people, and so on. There are further examples. I see no lack of imagination. The question is not who could have imagined the events of 9/11, but who actually scripted them and directed them. In the months after the 9/11 attacks, the same dual perpetrator was proposed, as would soon be proposed for the anthrax attacks, namely Al-Qaeda and Iraq. The Guardian said on October 14th, "Inquiries are adding to what U.S. hawks say is a growing mass of evidence that Saddam Hussein was involved with the September 11th hijackers." I hope you don't forget that this was an important theme at that time. We're sometimes supposed to forget, but it was quite evident very early. "Pressure is building," said the Guardian, "for a military attack on Iraq." And remember, this is 1 week after 9/11. One of the most revealing comments in this connection, at least revealing to me, quite startling when I first read it, is from Kenneth Edelman. Edelman was head of the Arms Control and Disarmament Agency under Reagan, and he gave the following advice to George W. Bush in October 2001. And I quote, "This is a historic moment. You have a mission. It is almost a divine mission. You have one task in life, that is to wage a global campaign against terrorism and weapons of mass destruction. It is virtually impossible to wipe out terrorist groups, but by God, you can wipe out countries that support terrorism." There are two countries that are not easy picking, but not tough: Afghanistan and Iraq. "I have no evidence that Iraq was involved in 9/11, but I feel it." What a good reason to carry out a war of aggression against the country, causing the deaths of over 1 million human beings there. I feel it. As we know, the case for Iraq's involvement in 9/11, put forward repeatedly in the lead up to the invasion of that country as one of several reasons they should be invaded, finally collapsed. But the defenders of the governmental narrative of 9/11 have continued to insist that half of their initial story was true. Al-Qaeda, understood here as a group of foreign extremist Muslims who hate the United States, was the perpetrator, and that, of course, remains the official story. I believe that one of the reasons for this continued insistence on Al-Qaeda is the lack of a suitable fallback position, the absence of a story B. The lone nut narrative just doesn't work here. No lone nut, regardless of skills and fanatical temperament, can simultaneously hijack four planes and in the ensuing years cover up the crime. If this crime was an inside job, like the anthrax mailings that closely followed it, the organizers were a large group. This group had power in the executive branch of government as well as in the military and intelligence communities. Now, we will soon be getting into some serious detail about the investigation of 9/11, and some of this evidence has not been given, at least in this form, in a public forum before. Suppose we decided to look more deeply into this matter of 9/11 and who did it. How would we go about it? How would we investigate seriously these events? It seems to me that there really is no mystery. We don't need new methods and we don't need fancy rhetoric. We need old-fashioned research skills, the kind of skills that are supposed to be taught in institutions like this. We ask questions, we assemble evidence, we put forward hypotheses based on our evidence, and we test them. In the remainder of my talk, I'll sketch out the first steps of the procedure. The route I'll take involves investigating the destruction of the Twin Towers. This is only one route of many, but it's a natural one for me to speak about because it's the one I've emphasized in my own research. Now, I wanted to begin this by showing a video clip, very brief, from 9/11 Mysteries, containing several eyewitness reports from people on the scene.
How do these firefighters describe the collapse of the North Tower?
We started running. Floor by floor, it started popping out.
It was like, it was if they had detonated.
Yeah,
detonated. If they were planned to take down a building. Boom, 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 boom.
All the way down. I was watching it and running.
And others give similar descriptions.
At 10:30, I tried to leave the building, but as soon as I got outside, I heard a second explosion and another rumble and more smoke and more dust. And then a fire marshal came in and said we had to leave because if there was a third explosion, this building might not last.
Like, it sounded like gunfire, you know, bang, 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 bang. And then all of a sudden, three big explosions.
We started walking down the stairs. We made it to the eighth floor. Big explosion. Blew us back into the eighth floor.
Do you know if it was an explosion or if it was a building collapse?
To me it sounded like an explosion.
But it was a huge explosion.
Chief Albert Turry told me that he was here after the events that took place this morning. He tried to get his men out as quickly as he could, but he said that there was another explosion which took place. And then an hour after, there was another explosion in one of the towers here. So according to his theory, he thinks that there were actually devices that were planted in the building.
Reports of bombs in the buildings, explosions. A CBS reporter to Dan Rather.
But I was coming toward the World Trade Center looking for CBS crews and asked a firefighter if he saw any. All of a sudden, there was a roll, an explosion, and we could see coming at us a ball of flame stories high.
Okay, so this was our little clip. Now, if you were able to hear it, or if you're familiar with that clip from other sources, you will know that most of the eyewitnesses here claim to have heard or seen explosions. Notice also that they're giving their accounts either on 9/11 itself or very soon thereafter. I want to start our inquiry here with this little clip. That's where we start our inquiry into 9/11. Now, there are two distinct, very good reasons why this little group of eyewitnesses is important. First, the existence of these eyewitnesses tells us that the explosion hypothesis, by which I mean the hypothesis that the buildings came down because of explosions, not necessarily explosives, that's another step, but explosions, was already being talked about on September 11th. Why is this important? It's important because it's often assumed by people that the structural failure hypothesis was the only game in town on 9/11. We're led to believe it was obvious to everyone on the scene that day that the buildings had collapsed due to structural damage caused by the planes. Only later did busybodies and conspiracy theorists try to muddy the water with their revisionist talk about explosions and demolition. This is actually historically false. And I just say that without any need to qualify it. Some things are false. Sometimes you can prove things are false. You can prove that's false. There were lots of people on 9/11 talking about explosions. There were people who assumed, and reporters who went on the TV assuming the buildings were blown up. That's what they saw. As far as eyewitness evidence is concerned, there is no original and obvious hypothesis. The explosion hypothesis is just as old as the alternative hypothesis and was just as obvious to many people on the day. Listen to firefighter Christopher Fenio, quote, "At that point, a debate began to rage because the perception was that the building looked like it had been taken out with charges. The debate ended pretty quickly because then World Trade 1 came down." So they were talking about the South Tower and how it had come down. Both of the leading hypotheses, the explosion hypothesis and the structural failure hypothesis, were expressed before the destruction of the North Tower, which is to say before 10:28 a.m. on September 11th. The eyewitnesses don't support the idea of an original or default hypothesis. If we were to insist on finding a default hypothesis, it would have to be the explosion hypothesis, for the obvious reason that all previous cases of the rapid destruction of steel frame high-rises have been due to planned demolition using explosives. And that's where you would normally start an investigation. But as far as the eyewitnesses are concerned, both hypotheses were articulated before 10:28 a.m., and with further refinements, these are still the same two hypotheses available today. In order to decide which one is correct, we must use old-fashioned research methods. Patriotism, ideology, and name-calling are completely useless. They simply don't get us anywhere. Now, before I go on, let me just explain why these hypotheses are so important. Sometimes I get caught up in this and I forget to say this to people. The point is, if these buildings were brought down through pre-planted explosives, and I think when we study the explosion witnesses, we end up with that conclusion, then this had to be in some form a domestic operation. And the whole Al-Qaeda Iraq narrative becomes very suspect, the same way, and in some ways for the same reason as in the anthrax mailings. The reason being that the perpetrators simply couldn't control all the science. There's a second reason, however, that this eyewitness video clip, this little clip I just showed, is important. It's precisely the testimony of eyewitnesses that typically leads investigators to go and look for evidence of explosions. Former FBI explosives expert James Thurman has written a useful book called Practical Bomb Scene Investigation. In this book this is a quotation, "The initial response to a bombing scene usually begins as a 911 call from a citizen reporting the sound or the actual witnessing of an explosion," end of quote. Thurman explains that the eyewitness report of an explosion should result in what he calls an infinite incident phase examination of the scene. This is an initial assessment, and it includes the search for physical evidence as well as, quote, "the solicitation of information from witnesses, if any, who may have observed the explosion," end of quote. Investigators will then launch a full-scale and detailed explosion investigation if they feel it's warranted. In other words, if they found some evidence in their first assessment. It's usually during the detailed investigation that the source and nature of the explosions will be determined. So, for example, that's when you would decide, was this a natural explosion such as we would expect in a fire? A blevy, for example, boiling liquid expanding vapor explosion, like a boiler blowing up, or is it explosive? That's the kind of thing you would discover in a detailed investigation. Well, of course, there were eyewitnesses on 9/11 claiming to have perceived explosions. We've seen a few of them in the little video clip, and we'll hear about more of them later. So the FBI, or whatever agency was involved in the examination of the crime scene, the FBI was, however, the main agency, should have carried out an incident phase examination of the scene. During this phase, they would look for further eyewitnesses and for physical evidence. Was such an investigation carried out? We don't know. There's no reference to it in the FEMA and NIST reports. No one, as far as I know, has found a clear reference to it in the reports of the FBI. The FBI's name for its investigation of the 9/11 incidents, strangely enough, is PENTBOMB, which stands for Pentagon Twin Towers Bombing Investigation. Presumably, when this name was assigned, somebody in the FBI thought a bombing had taken place. Perhaps this is related to what foreign correspondent Jack Kelly told USA Today on 9/11. Kelly said, and you can find him saying this on the internet, this video clip is on the internet, Kelly said the FBI's working theory on 9/11 was that a car or truck packed with explosives had been stationed in a parking garage under the towers. The buildings came down because the explosives were detonated at the same time the planes hit the buildings. Well, if this was the FBI's theory, and frankly, it's better than the one they eventually settled on, when did the Bureau decide explosives had not, in fact, been employed? And what was their evidence? And why don't they tell us? The 9/11 Commission report says, quote, the FBI told us they found no trace of explosives at the crash sites, end of quote. But in the 9/11 Commission report, the statement has to do with the hijackers and whether they had bombs on board their planes. It has nothing to do with cars or trucks in the parking lot and nothing to do with controlled demolition. And in any case, the 9/11 Commission doesn't tell us anything about why or when or on the basis of what evidence they reached this conclusion. The National Institute of Standards and Technology, NIST, as some of you know, has tried its best to avoid discussing explosions in the Twin Towers. In its final report on the destruction of these buildings, it devotes one dismissive and misleading paragraph to the explosive hypothesis. If the FBI or NIST were to look seriously for physical evidence of explosions, they would need to examine the steel of the structures, and they would need to examine the debris in the streets of Manhattan. But alas, by the time NIST started carrying out its major investigation, most of the physical evidence had been destroyed. The steel, amazingly, had been recycled. NIST was able to lay its hands on about 0.5% of the steel used in the towers, probably less. This is deeply disturbing, especially when we consider that the scientists who did get a look at some of the steel before it was recycled said things about it that are difficult to reconcile with the structural collapse hypothesis, including evidence of extraordinary temperatures. In the New York Times, one of these scientists reported evidence of steel from the columns having evaporated. What did that? Certainly jet fuel doesn't do that. Well, how about the debris in the streets? NIST has admitted that it hasn't looked for explosive residue in the debris. Their only answer to why not is we don't look for things that aren't there. Apparently, NIST still has no intention of looking, even though such residue has now been found by other scientists. And I'll refer to the important article giving that discovery in a moment. What about the FBI? Did it search the debris for explosive residue? In light of the eyewitness evidence and in light of its own guidelines, it had a clear obligation to do so. And the 9/11 Commission report seems to imply that it did, but we don't know. We don't know if it looked or not. Well, did the FBI, and I'm sorry this is kind of going on here and being a little detailed, but I am trying to build an argument. Well, did the FBI or NIST or the 9/11 Commission at least look for further eyewitnesses? Did they make a comprehensive survey of eyewitnesses? Apparently not. Did they at least examine carefully the testimony already in their possession that had been gathered by others? Not as far as we know. The 9/11 Commission report contains one brief reference to witnesses who thought they perceived explosions as the towers came down. Firefighters. The Commission pretends, in the face of overwhelming contrary evidence already in its possession, that these eyewitnesses had an impeded view of the towers and made a mistake. NIST, meanwhile, in a carefully worded statement, dismisses the explosion testimony of the New York firefighters. But there's no reason to believe NIST ever seriously studied this evidence. And I say that as someone who has seriously studied that evidence. We must conclude that the official bodies charged with investigating the destruction of the towers grossly violated standard investigative procedure. The conclusions they have drawn about the destruction of the towers cannot therefore be trusted. But perhaps you think I'm making too much of the testimony of a few eyewitnesses from a little video clip. So let's now ask whether that testimony is supported by other evidence. I want to make a distinction today between what I'm going to call corroborating evidence and converging evidence. By corroborating evidence, I will mean supportive evidence of the same kind. In other words, if you start with eyewitness evidence and you gather more eyewitness evidence, evidence of the same kind, we'll call that today corroborating evidence. By converging evidence, I mean supportive evidence of a different kind. So if you start with eyewitness evidence and you gather photographic and video evidence and physical evidence, we'll call that converging evidence. Not everyone makes this distinction, but some researchers do, and I find it useful. Let's take these one at a time, beginning with corroborating evidence. How many eyewitnesses are there, therefore, altogether, who speak of explosions occurring at the beginning of the destruction of the Twin Towers? Nobody seems to have done a complete, rigorous count, but my own current list stands at 154. My report on 118 of these eyewitnesses is available in the online Journal of 9/11 Studies, and you can just look it up and read them. The advantage of this article is I include the testimony of the eyewitnesses in an appendix, so you can read them yourself. Since I wrote that article, I've gathered more eyewitness testimony, and the process continues. So I'll now give you a graph that nobody has seen before that gives an overview of the testimony in my current list, organized by profession. FDNY stands for Fire Department of New York, PAPD is Port Authority Police Department, and the rest is obvious. So of the 154 eyewitnesses, 121 are from the Fire Department, another 14 are from the Port Authority Police Department, 12 are journalists, most of them working for major television networks, and 7 are listed as other. These are mostly civilians who worked in the vicinity of the towers or in the towers themselves. Members of the FDNY and PAPD are what we call first responders. So, 135 out of 154 witnesses are first responders, 88% of the total. Why is this significant? Because they're credible witnesses. They've had much more experience of explosions than most of us, and their testimony was given to superior officers as part of their professional duties. Before I show my next graph, let me pause to explain how I arrived at my list of explosion witnesses. Some critics suggest those of us pushing the explosion hypothesis include in our lists everyone who reports hearing a loud noise. If someone heard a boom or a bang, into our lists they go. This certainly isn't how I compile my list. The main criterion for inclusion in my list is that the witness must identify what he or she perceived as an explosion. If they see or hear, I heard a tremendous boom, that's fine, but they're not on my list. If they say I heard a big explosion, they're on my list. The witness must use one of the following terms, explosion, or the verbal forms, to explode, it exploded, etc. Blast, blow up, bomb, and implosion. I've added a category called other CD, meaning cases that don't involve one of the former terms, but that are strongly suggestive in some other way of controlled demolition. Now, when I compile my list that way, here is the graph we get. The explosion category is obviously by far the largest, with 112 eyewitnesses. But the bomb category, with 25 eyewitnesses, is extremely important as well, because most of the people reporting these bombs are first responders, police officers or fire department people, and it's clear that they aren't talking about the kind of explosion that they expect to encounter in a high-rise fire. They wouldn't call it a bomb if they thought it was a blevy or a smoke explosion or an electrical explosion or a natural gas explosion. Now, 154 eyewitnesses are a great many eyewitnesses. I wonder how many homicide trials in history have had this many eyewitnesses. Moreover, I've read a fair bit of social scientific literature on eyewitness testimony, its strengths and its weaknesses, and I believe this body of witnesses is very solid. What do supporters of the structural collapse hypothesis have to say in response to these witnesses? For the most part, they ignore them. When they deal with this testimony, they are usually reluctant to get into details. Some say the testimony can be dismissed because the eyewitnesses subsequently changed their minds and said now they don't think that they really were explosions. But a search of the fire department oral histories shows that somewhere between 6 and 14% clearly changed their minds. And this is a remarkably small figure, in my view, when we realize that they were aware they were going against the official collapse hypothesis. And by the way, the social scientific literature would predict that many firefighters would change their minds because the media and the authorities were pushing very hard the structural collapse hypothesis, specifically the pancake theory, during that period when these guys were being interviewed. Other critics say eyewitness evidence is soft, or as some people like to say, eyewitness evidence is notoriously unreliable. It helps if you frown and look serious when you say that. The truth is that this is a very misleading way to characterize eyewitness evidence as it is illumined by the social scientific literature. But in any case, you won't find many government officials making this claim because the government story of the 19 hijackers depends very heavily on witness testimony, and it's weaker testimony by far than that in my witness list. The government testimony is, in fact, mostly hearsay. It relies on what people claim eyewitnesses said. Today, many of the eyewitnesses themselves, such as the passengers on the planes, can't be interviewed because they are dead. Others, such as Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, the so-called mastermind, are under lock and key. And of course, KSM's testimony was obtained through extensive torture. He was also told that if he didn't speak, his son might be killed. I find it quite remarkable that the 9/11 Commission accepts Khalid Sheikh Mohammed's description of this and that, his eyewitness testimony to this conversation, that, so on and so forth, even though he's supposedly one of the worst terrorist killers anywhere around, supposedly knows how to deceive people. He's being tortured up the wazoo. His son's life is being threatened. He's probably being driven nuts by suffocation through water. But no problem. We'll accept that testimony, which would be completely inadmissible in any decent court of law. But when it comes to our firefighters and our police people and our civilians, we won't accept that. They must be all wrong. When critics try to deal seriously with the explosion witnesses, the usual points they make are two. Number one, the perceived events were not really explosions, but non-explosive phenomena such as the impact of falling bodies, the impact of falling elevators, the snapping of steel columns, and so on. All of the three that I've given are frequently mentioned. Or number two, they will say there may have been some explosions perceived, but they were the sort of explosion often encountered in fires, electrical, natural gas, and so on, and then had nothing to do with planted explosives. Well, let's take these one at a time. First one, the claim that these people didn't really perceive explosions, in my view, doesn't survive even a casual reading of the actual eyewitness testimony. How can falling bodies and the like explain testimony such as the following by Port Authority Police Officer Leclerc? Quote, "Suddenly there was a monstrous explosion with extremely high wind and debris, and the lights went out immediately. I was physically picked up and hurled across the concourse, slamming into a wall." It seems to me the obvious way to interpret that is that he experienced precisely what he said he experienced, a monstrous explosion. How can falling elevators and snapping columns explain what firefighter George Kozlowski experienced? "We heard that loud ba-boom. It was like an earthquake or whatever, a giant, giant explosion. Then this big gust came and I just went flying maybe 30, 40 feet, tumbling. I got up, got on my hands and knees because all this white shit was all over me. I just kept crawling. My ears were like deaf, you know, like when you hear a giant firecracker or something." I think he experienced what he said he experienced, a giant, giant explosion. Now, there is a more systematic way to determine if these people experienced explosions. We can list the specific feature of explosions and see if they show up in the witness accounts. Let me illustrate this method by analyzing the testimony of Sue Keene. Sue Keene was on 9/11 an officer in the Port Authority Police Department, where she'd been for 8 years. Before that, she'd spent 13 years in the U.S. Army on active service, including in the Middle East, where she received training on how to respond to explosions. She's a credible witness. I'm going to give six characteristics of explosions now, as described in former FBI man Thurman, his book, Practical Bomb Scene Investigation. I'll then match these to selections from Sue Keene's testimony as given to the authors of the book, Women at Ground Zero, which was a book written very shortly after 9/11, so this is fresh in Sue Keene's mind. This testimony by Sue Keene is also supported by her separate, handwritten, unedited submission to the Port Authority Police Department. Six explosion characteristics. We begin with the most common one, sound. Typically, we connect explosions with distinctive loud sounds. Sue Keene. A couple of minutes later, it sounded like bombs going off. That's when the explosions happened. Positive blast pressure phase. This is when the explosion happens, the shock wave rapidly disseminates and is accompanied by high winds, the movement of air away from the explosion. And this is what, in a Hollywood movie, you would see destroying structures and blowing out glass and hurling bodies and all that. The windows blew in. We all got thrown. Each one of those explosions picked me up and threw me. Characteristic 3, partial vacuum during positive blast pressure phase. So the air is moving out rapidly from the explosion, and the air in the vicinity of the explosion becomes attenuated or thinned, and you have a partial vacuum there. There was this incredible rush of air, and it literally sucked the breath out of my lungs. Negative blast pressure phase. The air rushes away, the vacuum is created, and then what has to happen? Nature abhors a vacuum, as they say. So the air then rushes back. So sometimes things will be blown away during the first phase, and other objects will then be dragged back, actually, toward the site of the explosion. What does Sue Keen say? Everything went out of me with this massive wind. She's talking about the air sucked out of her lungs. Stuff was just flying past. Then it stopped and got really quiet. And then everything came back at us. I could breathe at this point, but now I was sucking all that stuff in too. It was almost like a backdraft. It sounded like a tornado. Characteristic 5, incendiary or thermal effect, the heat from explosion. He threw me under the hose, which in a way felt great because I didn't realize until then that my skin was actually burning. I had burn marks, not like you'd have from a fire, but my face was all red, my chest was red. And finally, number 6, fragmentation and shrapnel. And this doesn't have to be purposeful fragmentation, as for example when the bomb maker creates the case for the bomb, which it knows will fragment and kill people. It could also be structural elements in a building that are fragmented, to take one example, by an explosion. But this ability to fragment, sometimes called brisance, is typical of explosions. What does Sue Keen say? There was stuff coming out of my body like you wouldn't believe. It was like shrapnel. It's still coming out. Okay. I have found no evidence that Sue Keen was led or pressured by anybody in this direction. I suspect the reverse was the case. By the time she gave these accounts, some people were telling her that there weren't any explosions. I don't think her accounts have been tampered with, and her handwritten report to the police, Port Authority Police Department, is directly available. It's been scanned in on the internet, and I'll show you an example. For those of you who like primary sources, there's nothing better than a handwritten account complete with lovely spelling mistakes. So here we have the handwritten memorandum, page 3 by Sue Keen. Massive amounts of debris, concrete dust, and bodies or parts were more frequent at this point. Then there was an eerie silence, and it was just like you knew something was going to happen. There just seemed to be one explosion after another. I was separated from the guys from the bridge by another explosion, massive again, sucking the air out of your lungs, and then just a wind, more intense this time, with larger pieces of debris flying, and so on. So this is what the Port Authority Police Department reports look like. Some are handwritten, some are typed, and they're just very much these people expressing in their own words what they witnessed. Invaluable material. What do I conclude from a study of Sue Keen? I conclude that she experienced explosions just as she said she did. Very large explosions. But could they, and now we get to the second objection the critics raise, could they not be the typical explosions one would expect in a large fire? There are two reasons. More than two, but two especially why I find this extremely doubtful. First of all, many witnesses are clearly convinced that the explosions helped demolish the buildings. I mean, there's so many people that say this that I don't know who to quote, but I took one example, Gary Gates. I looked up and the building exploded, the building that we were very close to, which was Tower 1. The whole top came off like a volcano. But if these eyewitnesses are correct, then these couldn't be explosions of the sort that typically accompany office fires. Blevies and natural gas explosions can sometimes destroy structures, but I haven't encountered anyone who has suggested that they could have destroyed these structures. Massive, powerful steel structures. And especially that they could, that exploding boilers and natural gas, electrical explosions, could destroy the Twin Towers by pulverizing them symmetrically from the top to the bottom? I don't think so. I've never seen anyone suggest that. But secondly, there were also many witnesses who perceived multiple explosions that appeared to be coordinated as if to bring down the building. John Busey, staff reporter of the Wall Street Journal, says, "I heard metallic crashes, and I looked up out of the office window to see what seemed like perfectly synchronized explosions coming from each floor, spewing glass and metal outward, one after the other, from top to bottom, with a fraction of a second in between. The floors blew to pieces." Now, it's fascinating that the Wall Street Journal is publishing this on September 12th, but already there's a little narrative frame around it where John Busey is being told that what he really saw was pancaking floors. So he says something like, "Unknown to me," you know, because he couldn't see it, "the floors were pancaking." But then he says, he tells us what he actually saw, and that's what's important. Here's Karen DeShore of the Fire Department of New York. "Somewhere around the middle of the World Trade Center, there was this orange and red flash coming out. Initially, it was just one flash. Then this flash just kept popping all the way around the building, and that building had started to explode. A popping sound. And with each popping sound, it was initially an orange, and then a red flash came out of the building, and then it would just go all around the building on both sides as far as I could see. These popping sounds and the explosions were getting bigger, going both up and down and then around the building." Unquote. If this testimony is accurate, it suggests the presence not merely of explosions, but of planted explosives. This is why I like to quote firefighter Kenneth Rogers, who seems to me not only a good witness, but a man capable of drawing the right conclusion. "We were standing there with about five companies, and we were just waiting for our assignment, and then there was an explosion in the South Tower. A lot of guys left at that point. I kept watching. Floor after floor after floor, one floor under another after another, and when it hit about the fifth floor, I figured it was a bomb, because it looked like a synchronized, deliberate kind of thing." What I've given you is a survey of the material contained in my own incomplete list of eyewitnesses. There are on the internet and in print many eyewitness accounts that I haven't yet vetted and added to my list. What do I conclude at this point? The initial eyewitness testimony we saw in the little video clip, which was our starting point, has been powerfully corroborated by additional eyewitness testimony. And now we move to converging evidence. "I don't want to try your patience much longer. I've been speaking for quite a while. So I'll choose three examples from many, many that are available. I'll begin with photographic and video evidence, considering those here today as one type, and then give two examples of physical evidence. And really, my aim here is not to do a thorough discussion of any of these, but to give you a taster and to give you an article you can go and read. And I think all of the articles are available free on the internet so that you can explore it in more detail yourself. Here's a photograph from a series of stills by a man named Richard Leffen that shows rapid ejections from the North Tower during its destruction. Leffen's photograph is confirmed by video footage of the event from a similar perspective. Note how closely the video frame below corresponds to the still photograph you're looking at now. It is, in fact, the same building at the same instant in time. It is almost identical, except that the perspective is a little different. I have taken this video frame, I've picked it myself out of the video clip in order to find the instant in time that's represented in Lethen's still photograph. The advantage, of course, of the still is that it's got more detail. The advantage of the video clip is that we can measure velocity and acceleration. So what caused these ejections? There are actually, if you know how to look, there's four here. There are the two obvious ones that are low down, one going out the side and one coming directly toward you, toward the camera. And there are two largely spent ejections being overcome by debris a little bit higher up in the, just in the beginning of the debris front. What caused these ejections, which traveled 40 feet in the first 0.4 seconds? NIST's lead investigator, the government investigator, Shyam Sundar, refers to them as, quote, puffs of dust ejected from windows by the piston effect of the falling upper block of the building. But if you look at the video frame on the right, so this is the same instant in time. On the left is Lethen's still photograph. On the right, with the History Channel insignia, is the video, the corresponding video frame. I showed you a close-up of it a moment ago. This is the distant shot. If you look at the video frame, you see that the so-called upper block by now, the piston, in the piston theory, has already been pulverized and is more like a cloud of debris. In fact, those who've analyzed this have shown that the cloud of debris resembles a piston in no significant respect. Now let's look at a video clip of the northwest corner of the North Tower, in which I can see, and I believe if you look you can see, multiple rapid ejections proceeding systematically down the northwest corner of the building. And I will show this twice because it's very fast and sometimes you can lose the detail the first time around. Essentially, this is the same clip shown twice, once from a distance and one closer up. And now the closer shot. These are things you have to study repeatedly. Okay, that will do. Well, I have studied it repeatedly, and it's quite possible to take this apart frame by frame. If we do so, we see, first of all, that there are ejections from parts of the building where there are no windows. The government theory has puffs of dust from windows. There are clearly some puffs from directly from the corner of the building, right through the aluminum cladding. We find ejection velocities that are remarkably similar, despite the fact that they come from different floors of the tower. And according to Professor Bazant of Northwestern University, they should be much faster as they proceed down. We see simultaneous ejections from multiple floors, which we shouldn't see according to the government hypothesis. And we see metal being distorted and even flung from the building. None of these observations fits well with the government's explanation, but if you'd like to look at an article which gives a very fine criticism of the government theory, then please look at Kevin Ryan's article, available on the internet. High velocity bursts of debris from point-like sources than WTC towers. In my view, these ejections are best explained as explosive in origin, and they are evidence that the buildings were subjected to explosive demolition. They are therefore converging evidence, which supports our eyewitness testimony. Secondly, my next two examples will be physical evidence. Next, consider the evidence of extremely high temperatures reached during the destruction of the towers. In 2008, a group of researchers led by Stephen Jones, physicist, published an article reporting evidence of temperatures up to 2600 degrees Celsius reached during the destruction of the Twin Towers. This evidence was derived from careful study of the Trade Center dust. The Jones article was consistent with a study published in December 2003 by the R.J. Lee Group and with the 2005 report of the U.S. Geological Survey, So if you don't like the Journal of 9/11 Studies, if you think everybody writes there, like me, for example, are crackpots, check out the other articles. Check out the U.S. Geological Survey report and the picture in that report of what they call an iron-rich sphere. You'll see I've said at the top, photograph of an iron-rich sphere in the WTC dust from a study by the U.S. Geological Survey. Iron melts and thus can form spheres at approximately 1500 degrees Celsius. As Jones's team pointed out, neither simple office fires nor jet fuel burns at anything like the temperatures discovered through this research. It's unlikely the fires in the World Trade Center exceeded 1000 degrees Celsius, and even this estimate is generous. By the way, there's not a lot of dispute on this topic. NIST doesn't dispute it. FEMA doesn't dispute it, the 1,000 degrees Celsius. Now, the empirical evidence we have from the study of the steel shows temperatures much lower than 1,000 degrees Celsius. We're left with a gap of at least 500 degrees Celsius in the case of the iron-rich spheres and 1,600 degrees in the case of the molybdenum spheres. These anomalies can't be waved away. The high temperatures suggest explosives or incendiaries used in the destruction of the towers. And finally, as a last piece of converging evidence, I refer you to the nanothermite article published by chemistry professor Niels Harrit and 8 others in the Open Chemical Physics Journal just over a year ago. This study demonstrates the presence of highly sophisticated energetic material, nanothermite, in the World Trade Center dust. You can see it here in the form of red chips, this picture being taken from the article. Whether this material was used for its incendiary or its explosive capacities, I don't know. But I've seen no convincing innocent explanation of its presence, though several have been tried. It shouldn't be there, but it is in large quantities. We may reasonably conclude that it was used to help destroy the towers. Did the publication of the Harrit article lead to headlines in North American newspapers? If so, I must have missed them. I sent the article to the science editor of what's probably the most internationally known newspaper in Canada, the Globe and Mail. I received no reply, and the article received no mention. Well, surely the article has at least led to energetic debate in our universities. I don't actually know. All I know is my own university. I managed to stir up a brief online discussion in my university, but those who were most vocal in the debate were too busy denouncing me as a crackpot to actually read the article. I eventually succeeded in persuading a professor emeritus of chemical engineering and a professor of chemistry to read the article, and both of them quietly told me that the article was academically sound and its conclusions presumably valid. But there has been no further debate, and as far as I can tell, little interest in a debate among the profs at my university. What an incurious lot they are. In an effort to make the nanothermite article more politically usable, Eric Hancocks of Toronto recently hired a lawyer to prepare a statutory declaration for Professor Harrit. A statutory declaration signed before an authorized witness lays its signatory open to the charge of perjury if the information provided is false. Professor Harrit, Denmark, City of Copenhagen, in the matter of a request by a Canadian citizen where an independent Canadian inquiry into the circumstances surrounding September 11th. 2001, I, Niels Harrit, and so on. Professor Harrit readily signed his name to his affirmation, which includes the following paragraph, and it's paragraph 6 that I want to draw your attention to. It is my view that the results of the aforesaid article attached hereto leads to the undeniable conclusion that materials found in the dust collected from the demolition of the World Trade Centers on September 11, 2001 contain all the necessary ingredients to comprise thermitic materials used in the deliberate demolition of buildings, and that this leads to the obvious question, how did it get there? Professor Hart asks a good question. How did it get there? You would think our politicians, journalists, and universities would be curious to find out. Was it placed there by Al-Qaeda? By Saddam Hussein's operatives? I don't think so. The evidence I've presented, both corroborating and converging, to support our initial eyewitnesses, points in the direction of a quadrant four operation. Like the anthrax mailings, the 9/11 attacks bear all the signs of a false flag operation from a group in the heart of the US administrative, military, and intelligence complex. It's hard to admit this, and even harder to know what to do about it. But since I'm giving this talk at a university, let me conclude with a plea to members of our universities. Most of you have looked the other way. Some of you have even poured contempt on citizens trying to find their way out of a maze of government lies and propaganda. But surely your duty is to look at the evidence these citizens have accumulated, to help them distinguish the good evidence from the bad evidence, to help them discern the truth. If you can find the courage to do this, you will discover that you've been given an opportunity to perform a great service for humanity. Thank you.